This is the first video in a series that looks at what the book of Revelation says about the future coming of Jesus. We will go through the book and highlight passages that speak of his return. In that way, we can get an accurate picture of what this book teaches about how and why Jesus will come in the future. We begin with Revelation 1. There we read in verse 7, "Behold, he is coming with clouds." Here John is in the middle of writing the prologue after having seen the vision that he recorded. With these words, he is highlighting the climactic event of the revelation he had received, which is the return of the Lord. What John writes here aligns with what he had heard Jesus say in the vision. In chapter 16, John recorded that Jesus said, "Behold, I am coming." But where in the book of Revelation is the actual coming of Jesus portrayed? The answer is in chapter 19, when he comes from heaven on a white horse. When we consider John's choice of words, he seems also to have alluded to a prophecy in the book of Daniel, where it says, "Behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven." We can connect this to Jesus' own words when he spoke of his return. He said, "They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven." Notice Jesus says people on earth will see him coming. These words of Jesus lead to the next part of verse 7 in Revelation 1 that says, "And every eye will see him." When John wrote this, he evidently had in mind the same as what he wrote in his first letter, where it says, "We know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." After the words, "every eye will see him" in Revelation 1:7, the verse goes on to say, "even they who pierced him." When John wrote this, he was clearly pointing to a prophecy in the book of Zechariah, where the Lord says, "I will pour on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. Then they will look on me, whom they pierced." Even though it was a Roman soldier who actually pierced Jesus, it was the Jewish authorities in Jerusalem that condemned Jesus to death and used the Romans to execute him. This tells us that those who are referred to as "they who pierced Jesus" are Jews. Thus John is underlining that Jews in Jerusalem will be among those who see Jesus when he returns. The last part of Revelation 1:7 says, "And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him." Here John was plainly referring to what Jesus stated about his future coming when he said, "The sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory." People around the globe will lament because they will realize that the one coming from heaven is Jesus, and many will be distressed because they have lived in rejection of him or in unbelief. The whole of the verse we have been looking at in this video says, "Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen." So what do we learn from Revelation 1:7? This verse tells us that the future coming of Jesus will be unmistakable. He will descend with clouds from above and will be visible to the inhabitants of the earth. We also learn from a prophecy in the book of Zechariah that this verse is building on, that when Jesus comes, he will come to Jerusalem. This is the second video in a series that looks at the return of Jesus in the book of Revelation. Let's continue our journey through the book and highlight passages that mention him coming. In that way, we can get an accurate picture of what this book teaches about how and why Jesus will come in the future. This time, we will look at what Jesus says about his coming in chapters 2 and 3. In chapter 2, Jesus says to his church, "Hold fast what you have till I come." Jesus wants those who belong to him to keep what they have received from him until he comes. To be consistent, we need to connect what Jesus says here to what John wrote in chapter 1, verse 7, which is what the first video in this series is all about. This verse says, "Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him." Therefore, in chapter 2, when Jesus mentions in the message to his church that he will come, he is saying that when he does come, he will come with clouds and be visible to people on earth. Then in chapter 3, Jesus says the following to his church. If you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. Jesus is saying that those who are not alert will not know the timing of his coming. They will experience his coming like the coming of a thief. We find an example of how a thief comes in Proverbs chapter 6, where it says that if you are lazy, poverty will come on you like a thief. A thief comes suddenly and unexpectedly. This tells us that when Jesus says he will come as a thief upon those who are not alert, his coming will be a sudden and unexpected event for them. It follows from what Jesus said that those who are watchful and alert will have the opportunity to eventually know the timing of his coming, so that he will not be like an unexpected thief to them when he comes. The expression as a thief is one that Jesus uses again in Revelation 16, where he said, I am coming as a thief. This is how the world will experience his coming, as an unexpected, unpleasant surprise when he comes on a white horse from heaven, as described in chapter 19. In line with this, the Apostle Paul wrote in relation to the future coming of Jesus, For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. Then in verse 4 he wrote, But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. What Paul taught here is the same as what Jesus taught. Those who believe in Jesus are not supposed to experience his return as an unexpected surprise, as those in the world will. Believers are to look for the signs Jesus spoke of in Matthew 24 and know that he is about to come. When Jesus had listed all the signs, he said, When you see all these things, know that it is near at the doors. And notice Jesus said know and not guess. He wants those who belong to him to know just before he comes that it is about to happen. Thus Jesus will not come unexpectedly as a thief for those who watch, and they will eventually know when he will come. In verse 11 in Revelation 3, Jesus says, Behold, I am coming quickly. Jesus is saying that when he does come, he will come rapidly. The Greek expression rendered quickly also carries the meaning of without delay. The coming of Jesus will therefore be right on time and will happen swiftly. To sum up, Jesus says in chapters 2 and 3 in the Revelation that we must keep what we have received from him until he comes. We are to be watchful and alert with regard to the time we are living in, so that we can register the signs of the times, and that way his coming that will happen quickly will not take us by surprise. This is the third video in a series that looks at the return of Jesus in the book of Revelation. In this series, our aim is to get an accurate picture of what the last book in the Bible teaches about how and why Jesus will come in the future. This time, we'll look at a passage in chapter 14 that alludes to the coming of Jesus. There John wrote, Then I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man. The mention of a cloud connects this verse to the verse that the first video in this series deals with, which reads, Behold, he is coming with clouds. The phrase, one like the Son of Man, occurs also in chapter 1, verse 13. John uses these words there to describe Jesus when he appeared to him on the Isle of Patmos. Thus, when John uses the same words in chapter 14, he is pointing to Jesus. The mention of the Son of Man in connection with a cloud points unmistakably to Daniel chapter 7, where the prophet wrote, Behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. Here Daniel sees a vision of the second coming of Christ. What John sees is therefore an allusion to the same event. The last part of verse 14 in Revelation 14 says, Having on his head a golden crown and in his hand a sharp sickle. A golden crown denotes having special honour, and the imagery of a sickle, which is a harvesting tool with a curved blade, points to reaping. The next verse in chapter 14 says that an angel came crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, thrust in your sickle and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe." This pictorial language is similar to what Jesus expressed in a parable concerning the coming of the kingdom of God when he returns and gathers his own. He said, "But when the grain ripens, immediately he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come." This can be coupled with Matthew 13, verse 39, where Jesus said, "The harvest is the end of the age." That Jesus receives and follows the instructions of an angel in Revelation 14 merely indicates that the angel signals the proper time for what Jesus is about to do. It aligns with what Jesus said about him not knowing the day or hour of his second coming. Jesus said in Mark 13, verse 32, that only the Father knows. When the time comes, it appears the Father will convey to his Son by means of an angel that the precise time he has decided on has come. The next verse in Revelation 14 says, "So he who sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped." In light of the last two verses, the reaping portrayed here appears to symbolize the gathering of the saints to Jesus at his coming. Evidently, Jesus reaps by way of the angels. They will gather people on his behalf. Jesus stated in Matthew 13:39, "The reapers are the angels," and he said a little earlier in verse 30 that they will gather the wheat, which he explained in verse 34 represents the righteous. Then in Matthew 24 he expressed that this reaping of the righteous by the angels is worldwide. There he said about himself, "He will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other." Also, Paul told about the ingathering of the saints at the coming of Jesus. He wrote in 1 Thessalonians that the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Paul continued, "Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air." In conclusion, Revelation 14 appears to show imagery that illustrates what will happen at the return of Christ. And the return of Christ is described in more detail in chapter 19 in the book of Revelation. We can see this connection to chapter 19 from verse 20 in Revelation 14, where it says, "And the winepress was trampled outside the city." This is a reference to what happens in chapter 19 when Jesus comes from heaven and destroys the Antichrist. There it says, "He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God." Thus, when Jesus comes to destroy the Antichrist, he will gather his saints to himself on his way down to the earth. This is the fourth video in a series that looks at the return of Jesus in the book of Revelation. We're in the process of going through this book and highlighting passages that point to him coming. In this way, we can get an accurate picture of what the last book in the Bible teaches about how and why Jesus will come in the future. In this part, we will look at what Jesus says about his coming in chapter 16. In verse 15, Jesus says, "Behold, I am coming as a thief." These words of Jesus are connected to the prologue of the book of Revelation, where John wrote, "Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him." Now, what did Jesus mean when he said, "I am coming as a thief"? We find an example of how a thief comes in Proverbs 6, where it says that if you are lazy, poverty will come on you like a thief. This verse says that a lazy person will experience that poverty comes suddenly and unexpectedly. Thus, when something or someone comes like a thief, it means that person or thing comes suddenly and unexpectedly. This tells us that when Jesus says he will come as a thief, his coming will be a sudden and unexpected event. Therefore, in Revelation 16, verse 15, Jesus is announcing to his own that is about to come and take the world by surprise. This would evidently happen on the day that is mentioned in the previous verse. Here John wrote of spirits of demons that were going out to the kings of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. This refers to the day when the Antichrist and his army on earth are decimated by Christ and his army from heaven when he comes back. All this is described in chapter 19. When Jesus says in Revelation 16 that he will come like a thief, we have an example of what the coming of a thief entails from Jesus himself in John 10, where he said, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy." That a thief comes to destroy is also attested to in Jeremiah 49, where we read about the coming of thieves by night who destroy until they have enough. This is how the coming of Christ will be for his enemies. They will be suddenly destroyed by him. We see this in the description of the return of Jesus in Revelation 19, when he destroys the Antichrist and his forces together with the ungodly. This aligns with what Paul stated concerning the coming of Christ. He wrote, "The day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night, then sudden destruction comes upon them." In the next part of Revelation 16, verse 15, Jesus says, "Blessed is he who watches." To watch means to stay alert. In context, Jesus is saying that those who at this time stay alert are blessed and will not experience his coming as an unexpected and unpleasant surprise. This is clear from what Jesus says in chapter 3. There Jesus states, "Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief." The opposite is also true. For those who watch and stay alert, the coming of Jesus will not be like a thief to them. That is why Paul went on to say in 1 Thessalonians 5, "But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief." From the context in Revelation 16, we see that what Jesus says in this chapter comes after the outpouring of the sixth bowl. In verse 12, we read, "Then the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up, so that the way of the kings from the east might be prepared." It is after this Jesus says, "Behold, I am coming as a thief. Blessed is he who watches." Thus we understand that in Revelation 16, Jesus is saying he will come after the angels have poured out the bowl judgments against the ungodly on earth. And as described in chapter 19, Jesus will come with his heavenly army and destroy the Antichrist and his forces. This is when those who watch and are alert will be blessed by being gathered to Jesus when he comes. This is the fifth video in a series that looks at the return of Jesus in the book of Revelation. We are in the process of going through the book and highlighting passages that point to him coming. In this way, we can get an accurate picture of what the book of Revelation teaches about how and why Jesus will come in the future. This time, we will look at what chapter 19 says about the coming of Jesus. Verse 11 says, "Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True." The rider on the white horse coming from above is of course Jesus. When John wrote heaven opened, it appears to have the same meaning as in Luke 3:21 that says heaven was opened at the baptism of Jesus when the Holy Spirit descended upon him. Thus in the Revelation, John is reporting what he sees will take place after Jesus has descended to the clouds, at which time he is revealed in the sky. Let's look at what the book of Revelation says will happen just before Jesus appears in the sky on a white horse. In verse 7 in Revelation 19, John heard voices say about the Lord, "The marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready, and to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright." Verse 8 here tells us that the bride of Christ is now dressed and thus ready to be wedded to him. Those who make up the bride are clothed in fine linen, clean and bright. In chapter 15, there is a reference to angels clothed in pure, bright linen. Therefore, the bride is clothed in the same way the angels are. Jesus said, "In the resurrection, they are like angels of God." Besides referring to living eternally as angels do, this statement by Jesus appears to show that the bride being arrayed in bright linen, like the angels, points to the resurrection of the saints. And the resurrection of the saints happens at the coming of Jesus. Paul wrote, "The Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise." As for saints who are alive on earth when Jesus comes, Paul stated, "The trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption." In this way, all those who make up the bride, both the living and the dead, will be clothed with glorified resurrection bodies, ready to meet the bridegroom. The bride being clothed in verse 8 in Revelation 19 is in close proximity to verse 11, the verse we started with, where Jesus is portrayed as having descended from heaven on a white horse. This tells us that when Jesus is revealed in the sky, as John witnessed in his vision, it is apparent that the great gathering of all the resurrected and glorified saints to meet Jesus in the air has just occurred. The continuation of verse 11 says, "In righteousness he judges and makes war." From this we understand that Jesus is descending on his white horse not only as a bridegroom but also as judge and warrior against his enemies on earth. Verse 14 in Revelation 19 says, "And the armies in heaven clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses." Jesus said he will come in his glory and all the holy angels with him. Paul wrote, "The Lord Jesus will be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels." Thus, when we read of the coming of Jesus in the book of Revelation, we expect him to be accompanied by angels. The heavenly armies are therefore made up of angels. Let's look at Revelation 19:14 again. It says, "And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses." As to the clothing of the heavenly armies, we have already noted that earlier in the Revelation, we read about angels clothed in pure bright linen. The bride of Christ that consists of all the resurrected and glorified saints is dressed in the same way as the angels. We saw in verse 8 that it says, "And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright." From this we can infer that all the saints that have been gathered to Jesus now come with him, and all the angels. We also see that verse 14 says the armies in heaven followed him on white horses. That angels can ride horses from heaven can be seen from the story in 2 Kings when Elisha and his servant experienced angelic protection. There it says, "The mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha." The next verse in Revelation 19 reads, "Now out of his mouth went a sharp sword that with it he should strike the nations." The sharp sword coming out of Christ's mouth is his powerful word. Isaiah prophesied of Christ, "He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth." The next part of verse 15 says, "And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron." The term rod of iron is a quote from Psalm 2 that concerns the future earthly reign of Christ over the nations. God says to the one he calls his son in this prophetic psalm, "You shall break them with a rod of iron." The rod of iron that we can call a scepter is a symbol of strong rule. The last part of verse 15 says, He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. What Jesus does here at his return to the earth is mentioned in chapter 14 in anticipation of his coming. The winepress was trampled outside the city and blood came out of the winepress. This imagery speaks of the crushing of Christ's enemies when he descends with his heavenly armies to the earth. Those Jesus treads on when he returns are mentioned in verse 19 that says, "And I saw the beast, the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together." This gathering together of the forces of the Antichrist was set in motion in chapter 16, where it says, "Spirits of demons go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty." The text goes on to say, "And they gathered them together to the place called in Hebrew Armageddon." This is a place in the land of Israel. The last part of verse 19 in Revelation 19 says, "To make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army." The armies of the nations that are gathered together against Israel now find themselves confronted with Christ and his army from heaven. Verse 20 reads, "Then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone." The demise of the Antichrist is also portrayed by Paul, who wrote, "The lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming." Revelation 19 verse 21 says, "And the rest were killed with the sword which proceeded from the mouth of him who sat on the horse, and all the birds were filled with their flesh." Christ's sword, that is his powerful word, will be enough to decimate his enemies, who are the kings of the earth and their armies. This aligns with Isaiah's prophecy of the second coming of Christ, where it says, "For by fire and by his sword the Lord will judge all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many." In conclusion, the verses we have looked at in Revelation 19 show us what will happen when Jesus returns. He will come with his heavenly army of angels, his bride will be glorified, and his enemies will be destroyed. We also learn that when he returns, he will then rule the nations of the world. This is the sixth and last video in a series that looks at what the book of Revelation says about the future coming of Jesus. We've been going through the book and highlighting passages that point to him coming. By doing this, we can obtain an accurate picture of what this book teaches about how and why Jesus will come in the future. This time we will look at what Jesus says about his future coming in chapter 22, which is the last chapter in the Revelation. In verse 7, Jesus says, "Behold, I am coming quickly." As we saw in the second video in the series, he says the very same words in chapter 3. The Greek word rendered "quickly" implies that the coming of Jesus will happen suddenly when the time arrives. Thus, Jesus spoke here of the way he will come and not the timing. We can compare what Jesus says in this verse to the prophecy in Malachi 3:1 that says, "And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come." Then in verse 12 in Revelation 22, Jesus again says, "And behold, I am coming quickly." Jesus is repeating that he is going to come suddenly, but not necessarily in a short time. In the continuation of verse 12, Jesus says, "And my reward is with me." This relates to the prophecy in Isaiah 40 that says, "Behold, the Lord God shall come with a strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him." Here we see that when the Lord comes, he will reign, and it's then he will reward those who belong to him. When Jesus comes, the statement in Revelation 11 about the rewarding of those who belong to the Lord will be fulfilled. Here we read of the time of the dead, that they should be judged, that you should reward your servants, the prophets and the saints. In the last part of Revelation 22, verse 12, Jesus says that when he comes with his reward, he is going to give to everyone according to his work. This conforms with what he says in Matthew 16. The Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works. All will receive what they deserve on the basis of what they have done. In verse 20 in Revelation 22, Jesus says once again, "Surely I am coming quickly." Thus, three times in the closing chapter of the book of Revelation, John records that Jesus speaks of his future coming. The only coming he can be referring to is his coming that is portrayed in Revelation 19. And that's because there is no other coming portrayed in the book. Chapter 19 tells us that when Jesus comes, he will defeat the Antichrist, be wedded to his bride, and rule on the earth. Now for a conclusion. In this series about what the book of Revelation tells us about the future coming of Jesus, we have seen that Jesus speaks about his coming in chapters 2, 3, 16, and 22. We have also seen that John refers to it in chapter 1. It is alluded to in chapter 14, and it is described in chapter 19 as happening after the end time tribulation. The book of Revelation clearly shows there will be a time of trouble in the world just before Jesus comes. In fact, one of the reasons for the existence of this book is to equip believers to face persecution prior to the return of Jesus.